So Columbia High School is what would be traditionally known as a comprehensive high school, which means we offer a range of courses for students who have a variety of academic and other interests, artistic, athletic, less vocational and technical than some people might think, but actually increasingly more technical given changes in education in the late 20th and early 21st century that we're in now. By that I mean things like robotics and science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. At the same time, we're an old and distinguished school, so we're very much kind of what is still called a traditional American high school. We serve over 1,800 students right now with a range of programs and courses that ultimately get them all to earning what are called Carnegie units, which were kind of invented about 100 years ago as a way to kind of categorize and to some degree stratify along class lines American workers and students at the turn of the century 100 or so years ago.
The school was founded almost 50 years ago, and our founder was Stanley Bosworth, and his idea for starting the school was to create a place where there would be no grades given, and the idea behind it was that we bring in practitioners and people who are passionate about what they do, and put students in a classroom with them, and that the passion of the teachers and the way in which the material was taught would ignite excitement on behalf of the students. So over the course of the past almost 50 years, the curriculum has developed really out of interest by the students.
Common Core, I think, is misunderstood by a lot of people. A lot of people think the Common Core is curriculum, as in you have to teach the Declaration of Independence or you have to teach about fusion and fission. It's less about that you have to teach that. It's more about the thinking, the critical thinking and problem-solving processes that you want students to be able to demonstrate and to master. So, for example, the Common Core doesn't say you have to teach To Kill a Mockingbird, but the Common Core says students by a certain grade level will be able to identify the way that characters are motivated by circumstances around them, and students will identify textual evidence of the way that characters or even in history historical figures have chosen to shape events. The curriculum is written and approved locally and then at the state level. Public schools, of course, though, are bound by state law regarding credits for high school graduation and things like that. So we have, I suppose, less freedom than a public, private or an independent school has, but that doesn't mean that you can't do really interesting things with curriculum.
One of my main concerns is that I'm gay, but in English, we have, I don't think, ever read any literature that has had LGBT characters. And if we have, then the characters haven't been significant enough for me to remember them. And even when we've discussed queer writers, it's been minimal. And even in history, we don't really discuss that kind of thing. And I don't know, that I consider my sexuality to be an important part of me.
I feel like some of my classes are relevant to me. Like the ones I picked, I honestly enjoy. And since coming to Columbia, I found that I actually like science more than I thought. So I guess in that respect, it's good that they kind of make you go outside your comfort zone.
I want to think I am going to need to use the quadratic formula in everyday life. But I'm perfectly aware that as someone who wants to write when they're older, that there's only so much that is going to be relevant.
When do we get to say definitively, this is not what I'm going to be doing? At what point does specialization become kind of just eliminating things too early on in life and just being set on a path and not being open to other things?
But at the same time, I think they should kind of like ask students, do you really want to this much math or this much science if you're not gonna like pursue it in the future?
I mean, I understand, like, you know, why you have
like math and English and history, but I don't want to do anything in math, English, and history. So for the like moment, no, because I know how to add, subtract, multiply, and divide. I know how to write an essay. So not all the time.
We teach things like, I understand the need to teach math, especially like algebra, which nobody likes. But there has to come a point where you have to say, like, this person is approaching college.
I think with math, if you're going to be an engineer, that's awesome, and grabbing trigonometric functions is really important. And, you know, they should have that offered. But I don't think that it's really necessary for every student to kind of go through that. It's just, unless you're going to be an engineer, it's just not applicable to life. I think we should have a more, like, finances-oriented math education.
I feel like the higher up you get in the school system, the more relevant they become. Like this year, I feel like I'm taking the most classes that I wanted to take.
You know, the majority of my day consists of classes that I'm really interested in, but I also have to, like, I don't want to say waste my time, but I have to spend a huge amount of time every night doing my math, which is just not something that I'm going to like go into in the future, and you know, it'd be really great to be able to focus more on biology or one of those classes that, you know, I legitimately know is going to take me somewhere.
I think that it's unfair to kind of force this subject onto students, especially this whole STEM thing they're trying to push on people. So. STEM is basically like science, technology,
engineering,
and math, and it basically, like, they want more kids to be interested in it, so they're kind of like forcing this interest, like, oh, yeah. Well, we really want to emphasize STEM.
Yeah. Take more math classes, take more science classes.
But if you don't like it, like, what's the point?
I find the American education system to be kind of backwards, because we seem to teach things that are really, really hard and seem to say these are the important things because they're hard, but we don't emphasize the basics enough, and I wish we could a little bit more, because just because something's hard doesn't mean it's important and doesn't mean you're actually going to need it.
I think that we are struggling kind of as a nation, as a community of educators, to figure out what it is we want our students to know and how we'll make sure that they know it. I want as much attention paid on the content piece, like what is the knowledge and why do we want our students to know it. And I think that we're actually having much better conversations about that than we did even 5 or 6 years ago.
My classes are definitely, most of them are relevant to me, especially my history classes and my music classes, because I'm really glad that I've had the opportunity to sing all sorts of songs.
I feel like they're really relevant.
I really like singing, so I take 2 music classes, and I like acting and a whole bunch of extracurricular things, so I take a total of 7 arts classes, and that's what I look forward to as well.
I really like, I mean, especially at a school like this, I'm not looking for something that's so relevant to me. Especially in school, like, there is such a wide palette of what we could possibly like, learn. And I think that the most interesting, the class that really tracked like, the most, like, the class that really tracked the most kids is the class that have no relevance to us at all.
I understand that our school system tries to make us well-rounded, but I think well-rounded can't be forced. You can only be well-rounded, like pretend I really like English, but I'd be interested in like certain parts of science, like epigenetics, I'm interested in. I think that's well-rounded because it's something I'm interested in. But I don't think well-rounded can be forced. I don't think it can be math, chemistry, science. Also, we exclude so many classes from our system. Like, we don't have a shop class. We don't have an auto class. There's so many different parts of being well-rounded that isn't included. We just kind of have a really small liberal arts education. And so many different careers and personalities and interests just aren't represented. So even well-rounded isn't achieved with what we have.
If you want to do something well, then I feel like you need to be fully invested in it. And how can you do that if you don't even want to do it?
I think what makes a good teacher / faculty member is when they're experienced and they know, and they take the time to know how you work.
Someone who remembers what it was to be like our age and kind of keeps that in perspective.
I feel that some of my teachers, they're not really aware that
as a student and you have other responsibilities and other work to get done.
So I think as teachers and our teachers who are passionate in what they're teaching, who want the students to be just as passionate as they are, and to really try to just teach you the subject and teach you how you can like apply it to the real world or what you want to do, you know?
They have the desire to share what they love about learning with their students. Many teachers, of course, as you know, have a great love for their subject matter. So teachers who love their subject matter and love the learning process, that's usually the recipe for a pretty excellent classroom teacher. I think good teachers are good at communicating because we've all had teachers who really know a ton of stuff and we love them because they love their subject matter so well, but they have a hard time figuring out how to share it with people who don't know it as well as they do. So people who can kind of break down big ideas and big themes into pieces that we can start to understand and want to dive into deeper, that makes for a good teacher.
In this community, it's up to the teachers to earn the respect of the students, not the other way around. In a lot of places, the students have to, the students are the ones who have to please the teacher or to get a good grade or have all the right answers. And here, that freedom to choose and to ask questions and just explore different things within a lesson is something that's valued.
Yeah, I mean, if the kids are interested in whatever book it is that I'm teaching, then oftentimes it will be the case that they ask the questions that are the most important ones to ask. Scouts is actually really good at that. He tends to come to class and ask the hugest, most important question. It seems obvious, but doesn't have a really obvious answer. And then usually if the kids are really into it, they'll talk out most of the points that we need to cover, and I don't really need to say all that much.
I guess just someone who really loves what they do and loves teaching and will love to help me out when I need it, because I do.
I think that good teachers are teachers that actually care about teaching or just knowledge in general. A lot of teachers I've noticed, like, they care about, like, teaching that they're supposed to teach, but they really don't care anything beyond that. I feel like that's really limiting and doesn't promote healthy learning.
A good lesson is something that sparks imagination, that sparks curiosity. It's not always about giving answers. It's more of the more exciting thing, I think, is asking questions and asking the right questions and thinking of great questions to ask.
A great teacher or faculty member truly believes in all of our students and also truly believes that in him or herself, in the teacher's ability to make a huge difference in the lives of students.
One thing I can't stand about teachers is like when they don't really care how their students do. Like they're like, well, here's like what I'm going to do, and here's a list, and this, and this. Try to keep up. I don't really care if you do or not.
I like it when teachers are really enthusiastic about their subject, and they, you know, they're really
geek
just,
out.
Yeah, it's
geek
cool
out.
When they're like when they get excited about what they're teaching, and then it, you know, even if it's not your favorite subject, you might at least be able to appreciate it.
I think I work best when everyone around me is like really into the subject, and like the teacher is like interested in teaching us, and like they're like really invested in teaching us, like they're as passionate, like they have a passion for the subject. So then I feel like, you know, I want to learn it too.
The most important thing is that the teacher needs to be involved and engaged. I think that a lot of teachers at some point just sort of check out, and they're presenting information. Presentations are boring. You need to have a conversation with your class. You really need to engage them and help them become excited about the topic matter. If you are just going to sit there and give a lecture, your kids are going to fall asleep, or they're going to start texting, or they're going to start eating something, whatever they do. If you have a conversation with them, they are engaged, they are involved, and they're going to care more about the lesson, more about the class.
Certainly, I think there's some obvious things like how much involvement does it take on the part of the students? Is there room for them to make their own decisions? Is it something that has been set up so they can relate to it in some way.
I would say a good lesson is one in which the students can actually relate to it, connect to it, get something personal from it.
My best work has come from when I'm really passionate about the subject.
Right, and so for me, I mean, because I can answer that question too, my best work is almost invariably not when I'm under pressure, but rather when I simply love what it is that I'm looking at and working on.
I think a teacher, a good teacher faculty member allows it, their students to sort of, not run the class, but the have the coursework be driven by what the students are interested in and sort of facilitate discussion rather than just lecturing. I think that doesn't really help us grow as like conversation havers, and a teacher who would just lecture wouldn't be good, especially at a place at CNN's.
So I don't think of the teacher as being able to do a good lesson just because the teacher is doing it. A good lesson is when the students are engaged and thinking and questioning and discovering. And that is a dialogue between the teacher and the students. There's no one set of ingredients that always creates that. Each class has its own cohort, its own character, and they have, teacher and class have to work together to create those good lessons.
College Board needs to stop with trying to be relevant because the SAT is just not relevant anymore.
I do not think the SAT is useful at all.
Oh, I'm the most anti-SAT person you could find.
Well, I can sort of see one advantage to it, which is just that it kind of standardizes everyone. Like, you know, colleges can look at lots of people's grades, and, you know, an A in one school with one teacher might be totally different from an A in another teacher, or in another teacher's class. And the SAT is kind of like just like a standard measure.
I think in reality it's practical, but I think like in theory, a different form of testing.
The benefits are that you can quantify things. I mean, the benefits are that you get data. But how useful the data is and how the data is used are the real questions to me, because it's a very limited lens to look at a student population and make judgments by it.
I think it is useful up to a degree. I think that it's important for us to take tests like SATs and such so that other people with other adults could know where we are and what we've been learning. But I feel as if maybe they shouldn't always count it towards some of our grade or like placement for next year or years to come, as you'd say.
It kind of gives some students like another opportunity to show like why they should get into college. Sometimes the questions or the setup is not useful or helpful at all, because sometimes it's like a test to know how to take tests, and if you don't test well, which some people don't, then I don't know how that can help you.
Yeah, I do like standardized testing because my grades are not very good, and so I do really well on tests and quizzes, and especially standardized tests, so that's like the one thing that's saving me right now. But I don't think it's right for everybody. For me, it is right, because I'm able to do well on those, and I feel like you can accurately measure at least some of my abilities through them, but I know that not everybody is able to be measured by them, so.
I do think there is some value in that you can compare how a student does in one school to how a student from another school does, and so you really have you know, some criteria that you can take students from different backgrounds and look at them together. I do think it can work to keep schools honest in terms of, are their kids really learning what they're supposed to learn? But I do think that if the standardized test becomes the be-all and end-all of the education, a school is really in trouble, because that's not supposed to be the focus of what kids learn. So I do think there's some value in it, but also some real inherent danger.
It's basically just a measure of how well you can take the SAT and
how well you're as a student.
Yeah, exactly.
Everyone is different, so how are you about to give something standardized to everyone to assess like people's intelligence? Like, that's just not how people work.
So it makes no sense to me why that would ever make sense.
No.
Just no. I mean, not only is it non-profit, even though you have to get the blue books, and then you think college board, you just pay,
it's like a monopoly.
And then they have the AP. It is a monopoly.
If like a certain kid could pay for SAT classes and stuff, they obviously have an advantage over someone who just has to study on their own and just like takes it and see what happens.
It's a useful tool, just like lots of other things I think are useful tools to help us understand what students know and when they know it. But I think that when, for all kinds of different reasons, we have a test that we pay money to take that colleges and universities use as an indicator of readiness, that could be a great thing. But when you start to be able to do things like take classes to improve your scores or take it lots of different times and things like that, I think it's become less about what you know or want to know or value knowing and more about how we've allowed a particular thing to kind of have a power that maybe it shouldn't have.
It doesn't take into account like people's economic circumstances, you know, like what they're actually good in. Like they may not be good in math or like English, but it doesn't mean like they're a lesser of a student.
The rich people, they'll end up getting tutoring for it, and the like, My parents were like, okay, let's throw money at the problem and send you to private tutoring sessions. And I think it's really easy to buy a good score. It measures how well you take the SAT. It measures a very narrow amount of skills. Some of the material that it covers is obsolete.
Like with score choice, you know, you can choose which scores go to colleges and which they don't see. So that means that, you know, you can take it again and again and again if you have the funds to do that. And it's not really fair to people who don't.
Had, you know, hundreds of students over the years who've been incredibly intelligent and gifted and don't do well on standardized tests, or certainly don't show how able they are on a standardized test. And I've seen lots and lots of tests that ask questions that either are stupid or wrong, or most often have multiple answers depending on where you come from. And so if you don't think like the test designer, then you don't get the right answer, and that doesn't have that much to do with anything.
I think that they are occasionally forcing a round peg into a square hole. And I think that it can be very stressful for children who don't necessarily test the best or the most effectively in that manner.
How are you going to measure like intelligence on a time situation? So there's really pressure then. I mean, what are you trying to do? You know, how can that say how smart you are? Because you can answer certain accept like whatever amount of questions in a certain period of time, you know?
With the essay, it's more testing, okay, can you write 2 pages of words with paragraphs and indentation in 25 minutes and use as many big words as you can? And so like everything else just seems to be testing how well you can navigate trick questions rather than how well you know the content.
You know, you're asking a kid to sit down for, you know, an hour, a couple of hours, and take a test, and you don't know what situation that person is in that moment. I had a friend who had her appendix burst during the SAT, like, and obviously that's an extreme, but, you know, people get migraines, people get, you know, stomach aches, like, I don't know, just the thought of, like, having to take a test, like, that's not a way to assess somebody's intelligence.
I don't think the SAT is useful because I think it in no way actually measures our intelligence or ability to be in college. I think it measures our ability to take a certain test, and lots of people aren't good at taking certain, like the SAT, and it's designed for a certain group of people to do well in it and a certain group of people to not do well, and so I don't think it's helpful at all.
Well, okay, so this is what I think about tests in general. I think tests should be used what tests are good for. Tests are good to help students and teachers know what students have learned so far, possibly, and what they still need to learn. Tests are good as diagnostic tools. They're good when they're medium stakes or low stakes. I don't believe in any high stakes testing. I don't believe that tests are precise enough or general enough or accessible to everybody equally. so that they really measure in a high stakes way what a student has accomplished or a teacher has accomplished. But I do believe in tests. I just think that we should not, I don't think we should use them to judge schools, judge principals, judge students. I don't think we should tell students that based on one test, they can't graduate. But we should have tests all the time just to figure out what we know and what we still need to learn.
You know, one size just doesn't fit all, and it's like impossible to make a test that, you know, caters to everyone and assesses everyone correctly.
I think the SAT should be eliminated completely because it's measures how well you take the SAT at 7:30 in the morning on a Saturday.
School is definitely the main cause of my stress.
School is the only cause of my stress, actually.
Yeah.
It's my only cause.
My only cause.
I think I can think of way better motivators besides stress. Many better motivators than stress.
I don't think it's school in general. Mm-hmm. I think it's just certain aspects of school, really.
You know, the cause of my stress varies. Like, honestly, it's difficult to pin it all on school.
I don't think I really have that much school-related stress because all the classes I take are classes I want to take, so I'm not stressed out about it. It's fun for me. And, yeah, school isn't that much of a stress.
I've never really felt sort of stressed until now because, like, especially the APs are, like, coming up. So that's kind of...
Yeah, like, S&M's, like, I've been relatively careful. Yeah.
I think just all the parts that school has just kind of starts to pile up, and then it's hard to ask someone to like balance all that while getting a grade.
Factors taken in isolation don't really make that big of an impact by themselves, but like when you take, you know, an academic workload combined with extracurricular activities and things, and then you combine that with like, you know, social life and family life and that kind of thing. And also when applying for colleges, which I don't know if that constitutes as academic exactly, but it's kind of another thing that you have to be aware of. It can be overwhelming.
Part of it's my fault, I think, just because I've chosen to do so many extracurricular activities and stuff. But the fact that I'm like usually at school like an hour or two later each day, and like sometimes I'm here until 9 o'clock at night, and then on top of that I have multiple hours of homework to do.
School in combination with everything else that just goes on in people's lives just, you know, creates stress.
Yeah, I do think stress is a helpful motivator, but only to a point. So stress is an indication of caring, of wanting to do well, of being concerned about the outcome. And I think that all of those things can be positive things in relation to motivation and preparing and doing well and being concerned. There is a negative aspect of stress, of course, which is that it can be debilitating. It can cause a person to care so much about how he or she is perceived that that person forgets about why they're doing it, the joy in learning or in performing.
Depending on the student and what they're aiming for, right now it can be pretty ridiculous. I think there also are plenty of students who don't put any kind of stress on themselves or don't necessarily respond to stress. But from what I've seen of high-achieving students, they're kind of going nuts, and it doesn't seem to be for anything in particular, and I'm kind of waiting for the revolution to come.
Like in the fall, my average school day was waking up in the morning, then coming to school for like however many hours school is, and then going to tennis practice, and then coming home and like eating dinner, and then doing homework till like 2 a.m., then doing it all over again. Literally getting like a couple hours of sleep.
I'm usually pretty good about getting work done, but nevertheless, I sacrifice sleep to do that. And lack of sleep makes me more stressed.
It's like a horrible cycle. You miss lunch because you have to finish your homework,
exactly.
And then you're like tired throughout the whole entire day, and then you go home and you're like, oh god, I don't want to do this, and you try to do your work,
and then
you need like a
sometimes.
Break, so of course you're going to like go online and do that
yeah.
fun stuff, and then it's like 10, 1, 2, 3 morning, and then you're like tired, you fall asleep, and you wake up, and you're like, no, I didn't do my homework, and the cycle
yeah.
continues.
Honestly, lack of sleep. That's
nope.
honestly number one. Every night I have like a half hour drive, and then like sometimes, and then I go to sleep at like 11:30 and I get up at 5:30, and that is just not healthy.
Lately, I have been like falling asleep really early because my body is retaliating against me.
You have tests, you have homework, that's stressful enough, but the stress of those things is amplified by like 100 times when you also know that you're gonna go home and you're not gonna get enough sleep, and then you're not gonna get enough sleep the next night, and it's just gonna start like, you know, rock sliding and you'll never catch up.
Well, it's brought up to me a lot that like, if you don't do this, then how do you expect to get into college? Or, you know, like stuff like that.
Being stressed about college comes from being stressed about academic work, I think. And sort of vice versa, but I think it all comes down to my grades and stuff like that.
If you don't do this, you'll fail. If you don't do well this year, you'll never get into college. If you don't behave, you'll never graduate from sixth grade. This kind of thing is said to students all the time, and that's very negative.
I do get stressed about school. Usually about math, because I'm just not predisposed to math, and you know, it's stressful that so much rides on that, but I'm just terrible at it, so.
And like, if I get a C in a class, then that's like really bad for me, and my parents are on my case, and I'm on my case, and I feel bad about myself.
It's not just taking the isolation, oh, I really want this good grade, it's because, oh, my grades are going to influence my future. You know, that constant awareness that what you do now is going to have an impact on your future, that like, oh my god, if I fail this test, I'm not going to get into a good college kind of thing, and it's like, it sounds kind of silly, but when you think about it, it really, it's
like,
kind of,
I mean, it's, yeah, it's, yeah.
I think a lot of students understand that making it to the right college sets them up for a career path, and I think whether or not they know it, consciously know it, I think that the pressures of getting into the right school can be overwhelming.
The only amount of stress I ever get is just from like a really overabundance of homework.
The main cause would probably have to be, for me, work.
The main cause of my school-related stress is homework. It's a combination of my procrastination and then the large amounts of homework the teachers assign.
Like, you'll get one class where you get like five pieces of paper that you have to do like annotations and questions for, then you have another class where you get another set of papers, and then another class where you have to do homework online, and then that just becomes really hard to keep up with, and it does end up stressing me out a little bit.
I feel we get way too much homework, and it's unequivocal with the amount of schoolwork we actually do, and it doesn't relate too much with what we actually do in schools.
It's definitely kind of, it's the motivating factor of me getting my work done, but I don't think it is helpful. It's helpful, but I don't like it.
Because you feel like by being stressed, you are preparing for your future, in a way. You feel like being stressed is kind of the way in which you work towards success, and I think that's one of the impressions that a lot of students have, and it's a harmful impression.
It can be helpful, but it could also break a lot of kids. I've seen it in my junior year, it's breaking a lot of my friends, and kids kind of falling off the deep end. But, I mean, it could definitely be helpful. It's scary that every single night you have to go home before hours of work, and you feel like you're not doing enough, and have so many things pulling at you.
I do not think that stress is helpful. I think that it's counterproductive, and I think that there is far too much stress on high school students, high school teachers, on society in general, and that making the classroom and the school setting less stressful, and not that it has to be enjoyable, but as a place where you can kind of grow and exist comfortably and not in a stress-filled environment is much better for everybody and for their education.
I would say it's a little bit intellectually backwards, but that doesn't mean that it's not effective, right? It is the case that people do a lot of work because they have to get it done, right? But again, this is sort of like an answer I gave you before. It's not the case that they love doing it or do it well because of that, right? I think you will get more quality work from somebody who is really interested in what it is that they're doing. And in that case, there's very low stress. I mean, it might be the case that you have to like, get it done by a certain date, right? But if you want deep, serious work, the motive, right, the point should not be to jump over a hurdle. It should be the work. Mm-hmm. The point should be to do it and to love doing it and find it interesting.
My entire life is wrapped up in school though, so there's only so much I can do about that, and I would love if, you know, that could be lessened, but, you know.
I mean, I have other stressors, but I'm like, I'm the type of person who just gets over that kind of stuff, like, whatever.
Yeah, but with school, you just can't escape it.
I don't want schooling to be about lots of stress and frustration and students constantly feeling that they can never catch up and never get ahead and that they don't know what the purpose is. I think if you really have an understanding of why you're in school and what the process of schooling will do for you, not only while you're in it but later, then there's not the type of stress that I think you're describing. Because a lot of the stress I think that's on students is kind of artificially manufactured stress about the value of grades and standardized test scores, and that worries me.
The way American society is engineered is that we spend, you know, the majority of our week, 5 days, looking forward to the 2 days after it where we don't have school. But then we spend those 2 days stressed and procrastinating and worrying and then working on assignments for school.
I'm going to say 95% of people come in and they don't want to come in. And then those same 95% of people, when it's almost time to go, they want to leave. They can't wait to leave. It's the thing is that school is kind of broken.
I have ADHD, which is challenging, to say the least, in school. The homework load is sometimes so much, and I have trouble trying to explain to a teacher, like, I may be doing this, but I am listening, or, like, I get distracted, but I need this, or I need this tool, or I need to be able to have, like, written instructions, and it doesn't mean I'm not intelligent, it just means that I have trouble following verbal instructions. Among other things, it's hard to have ADHD when you're in school, especially if you like learning, because you're there, like, you can understand it, but it's just out of reach, and you get distracted, and then you do an assignment, and you forget it at home, and then you're upset at yourself, so you don't bring it in for a month.
A lot of people learn through ways that we just don't teach, like auditory, like a lot of people don't learn through like written text or like listening to somebody talk. That's just what some people like need visuals, like that like, and it's unfair to them. It's not fair that some people get the short end of the stick because, oh, that's just not how they learn. Then that's why should we have people that, why should we make it so that people can't have a good experience at school?
Better if you go to school in an environment where you actually like want to come, because school's about learning, and I feel it's become more as a competition to who can outweigh who in what subject instead of actually like just a place to learn, you know, and grow.
I think that the accent on grades ties right back into the question of stress, and I think that those things are really, can't find the word for it, counterproductive to a truly educational experience. I was having a conversation with a colleague about grade pressure and parents needing their children to get certain grades so the child can get into a certain college, and how the experience in the classroom does not matter to that parent. All the parent cares about is the A or the B. All other parents care about is, did my child pass? So I really think that grades are not what it's about, and I would prefer a class that was just focused on learning from the material, learning from each other, and less grade-centered.
I actually learn best when there's not, you know, a grade at stake or like a, I don't know, a menacing test coming up in the future.
Like, as important as school is, and obviously like everyone knows that, I think it kind of devours kids' lives, and it's to the point where in class you're not really trying to learn and grasp the subject as much as just trying to get an A.
Our society is becoming more about using tests to measure and punish and pay people. So you know, we try to resist this. This is something I try to resist. I try to talk to my students about separating the learning process a little bit from the fear of testing. I mean, sometimes students are sitting there and they're worrying every minute, are you going to ask this on a test? And I sometimes have to stop and talk to my students, if I only teach what I can test you on, then I can't teach you that much. Because it would be very unfair to test you on all the big ideas I want to introduce.
I can almost not imagine giving them, too. It would seem sort of silly to me. Because, like, to get a poem from Alex and to, like, have to put a grade on it seems, I don't know, just crazy. I wouldn't know how to do it. I wouldn't, what am I supposed to say about this deeply emotional thing that he's delivered to me? I'm certain that smart people know how to do this, but I just don't. And maybe it's just that I'm a product of this place and I couldn't do it, but I don't know. It seems to me that I can deliver much more effective commentary on an essay or even on a piece of creative writing if I just take a little bit more time and write a few more paragraphs and don't decide to judge it.
It's just basically saying who can do better, checking Power School to see, oh, I got one up on that person because they got a B minus and I got an A. Well, I mean, how I see it, I just see like how people take certain classes that they may not necessarily be interested in just because it's an easy A, or because they want that AP credit, even though they don't like it.
Yeah. It seems you have to, it seems a lot of more memorization than learning. Like, oh, I have to remember like these dates and these scientists and these properties of something so that I can get an A on this quiz. And then like a week later, it's like half in your memory.
As someone who really likes learning and who really enjoys knowledge in general, I don't find school to be about learning anymore for most of my classes. I find it to be about grades and about taking tests and about short-term retention. And that's not what I want school to be. I want school to be a place where I can go to learn and to prepare for life later on.
The conditions of school should be a lot different. It should be a lot more open. Personally, that's what I think. I think that that school is just too closed and formal, and like this is the way it's going to be done, and there's nothing around it.
I don't think it's like a thing that's like, it's just how it is and we just have to deal with it. I think some things you're doing right, but it can just be better for everyone.
There's a great saying I think that can be kind of applied to schooling today in America, which is not everything that can be counted counts, and not everything that counts should or can be counted. And I think that's a really useful thing. You know, it's helpful to understand if you're learning to conjugate verbs in French that you've done it correctly. But whether or not that requires grades and tests and quizzes is a really powerful conversation. But in America, the way we do high school, we've been doing it for about 125 years, more or less the same way. So I think it might be worth rethinking. So while I was making this, a lot of people asked me what inspired this, why are you doing this? And the answer is very simply the students and teachers that you just saw. The students from St. Anne's, the ones from my school, the anonymous ones from the beginning from, you know, all over the country, and the teachers as well. Seeing my friends and peers stressed about this grade or that grade or this test or the SATs or the AP test or whatever is kind of sad and scary in many ways, and I can only imagine what it must be like for people in worse school districts. School is supposed to be a place about learning and growing and maybe beginning to find out who you want to be in the world and what you want your place in the world to be. And I think that we need to sort of come together as a nation and ask ourselves, you know, whether or not that's happening and why it isn't happening for everyone and how we can make it happen for everyone. A lot of times as students, we think to ourselves that, you know, we can't do anything about our situation and we just kind of have to suffer through it and
be stressed and be sad and not sleep. And I don't think that's true. I think that if there was more communication between teachers, students, administrators, curriculum designers, I think that we could have really great, you know, school system going in this country. It is so often said that children are the future, and we want to make sure that that future is as bright as it can possibly be. And that starts here, in schools.